It's so exciting to have joined me on this special 50 years of celebrating God's faithfulness. Matthew Carter, many of you recognize Matthew. 50 years of celebrating God's faithfulness, Matthew. Thank you. And tell everyone where you're at in the Carolinas.
I'm in a small town called Mebane, M-E-B-A-N-E. Everybody calls it Mebane. It's between Raleigh and Durham, just between Durham and Greensboro. It's right on 85, and I'm in the country, even though it's an interstate. I love it. And back, I'm really back to where my family tree, my maternal family, were slaves in the late 1780s, about 10 miles north of where I live. And it's a place where all my great-grandmothers buried and great-grandfather, and the history here is of my family on my mother's side has been just rewarding. I'm finding all these fourth, fifth, and sixth cousins that I didn't know existed. So it's really a great place.
Well, let's go back. You got involved with us back in 1990. It's been all these years right now.
Yes.
That's quite a few years now, with almost 32 years ago.
And I think I came there in 88. And I remember one of my first Sundays, you came to the church I was pastoring. And out of that experience, about 2 or 3 years later, that's when I really got involved with you. But it was during my period as pastoring on over on Park Avenue that I learned we did some things with you. I learned more about the homeless, which I wasn't aware of. And I think it was a transformative experience of meeting you and being around a ministry that I think I've hungered for. I thought about that being a part of institutional church. A lot of times we talk about Jesus, but in your ministry, I learned that it's about people. It's about more than just Sunday morning. And it really impacted my life.
You were an Episcopal priest at the time. I say you were an Episcopal priest at the time.
Yes.
And you opened up your church to homeless women and children.
Yeah, and that was the straw breaker. But the transition had already gone. God put it on my heart that the church, and I had been in a church since I was 9, we do a lot of talking in the church, but I think a lot of people, I'm finding more people are looking for something more than just talking. I think James, the book of James was right. We talk a lot, but our action don't follow our words.
So you started that. I was so grateful. I'd gone to church after church, and here's one that opened up its doors and took the homeless in. I was so excited. I finally found a church to do it. And then later I began to feel, wow, he ended up getting fired because I got involved with him.
Well,
he got kicked out of the Episcopal church. God help us.
No, but I took it to any church. I found that some of my members had ownership. It was like, we talked this message about love and the poor and caring. And man, those women and children moved into our church. And the people, some of the people were just nasty to them. And I'm saying these were some of the leaders of that congregation. I'm not faulting anything, you know, I came out of that. But you learn that it's not just about words. The church has to be about action. Faith has to have legs to it. And we are still a lot of words out there, but little action when it comes to understanding. I was thinking the other day, we talk about the Ten Commandments, but Jesus summed it up. Love God with all your heart and your mind. And love, see, we forget this one. Love your neighbor as yourself. We talk about the first part of it, but we rarely talk about the second part of it.
Well, I'm so glad you could join us on this, because actually New Life Evangelistic Center travels down through two tracks. And a lot of the programs I've done lately have been the one track, which is so important, and that is the ongoing compassion, the daily outreach. The second track, though, has to do with social justice. It's like the story of the Good Samaritan. You know, it's great to pick them up, take them to the inn, but sooner or later you got to do something about the robbers that are beating people up and putting them on the side of the road. So we've had to confront local politicians, the whole issue of gentrification, and you started doing that. You got thrown out of the Episcopal Church, but you didn't stop. You and I kept working together. In fact, we got locked up together.
Yes. You know, I think about that. It's not a badge. It's something because it was out of the 39th Street development. But see, when we talk about that and we talk social justice, but when you read Jesus's ministry, he went to the synagogue. We know he went there, but he was from this place to that place to the other place. It was never just in a building. He was in people's homes. And most of the healing he did wasn't on Sunday morning. Yeah. And what I found in New Life was this 7-day-a-week, 24-hour-a-day ministry. It was like meeting people, healing them and praying for them in their homes, in the alleyways. And most churches don't understand that experience. But it is the ministry they talk about all the time. But few of them really experience it.
I remember that day we did get locked up. I'd been locked up once before, and they let me out quickly because I was with all these people, and I started preaching the Lord to them, and they threw me out after about a couple hours when I tried to get in the old city hospital and use it to help the homeless. This next time around, you and I were out there with a number of people. We were put in a cell with a homeless man, and here you and I are on that hard bench all night long, and I wondered, why is this guy wearing his jacket when he's getting locked up in the middle of summer? He's smart. He used it as a pillow. We didn't have a pillow all night. There we were, like Peter and Paul, but we praised God, and it was a tremendous experience. Then they dropped all the charges later again, like they've done on all these.
But that's one of those biblical experiences. We read about Paul and singing. I remember the songs, just the singing that night. We almost sang songs about the Lord all night long. And it was one of those nights where you realize that when we talk about being in prison for the Lord or doing something for the Lord, how much peace he can give you. And I didn't worry about being in jail at all, but the experience of learning what God can do and give us peace when we do what we are supposed to do for him. I'm getting older now and maybe understanding some of this stuff we go through. I think the Bible is like that. I think they learned after going through something how God has been with them. I treasure those moments of jail, of it being next to the building we wanted to take over for the homeless. I remember us putting a plan together and going to the city, and they rejected the thing. But there was joy about it. And then we took it over, and then it came to arrest us. It was just one of those transfiguration experiences.
When we went to mow the grass in front of the old city, city hospital, because they sent everybody a notice and their grass had gotten so big. And then we went out there to mow it, and we were all locked up. But you know, you went years after that, you went to Oregon, but you still happened to always show up in town. I don't know if it's because I knew Matt Carter was coming to town. We got involved in something. You were with me when that tornado hit Joplin. I was thinking, wow, here's Matt's in town. What's going to happen now?
The footage from that I still look at. Remember the lady in the tub, the guy sitting on a commode in the house, the vanishes. The power of nature. And I think when we talk more about global warming now, I really am aware of that experience that we have. I was in St. Louis and we went out the next day in the dump. I'm going to tell you how dumb I was. We went into a Wendy's and I was asking for water. The water lines were all blown. Yeah. I mean, the privilege of us coming in and say, I want some water. And we've just had one of the worst storms in Missouri. I felt embarrassed.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of us are like that. We we downplay things that we should understand more. So it's a matter of learning God, learning about him, correcting who we are.
We have so many memories together. I remember taking you into a grocery store in Marshfield and the little girl telling her daddy, I don't know if she's ever seen an African-American before.
The travel with you in rural Missouri taught me that people stare and that people talk about other people. You know, I was in a barbershop the other day and a person was just talking about all these people, how bad they were. And I said, have you ever met anybody like that? No.
Yeah.
But they got all these opinions about them. But when you get out there and see how people are being taught regarding other people, and then you experience that, you understand the Bible about how the Jews felt about the Samaritans, how the Jews felt about Gentiles, and it's still very, very real.
I think you're with me when we had the homeless actually camp outside. Were you with me when they camped outside of the Veterans Coming Home Center in Springfield?
Yes.
And you were with me when we set up that community at 44 in Vandeventer, and I got arrested that day and hauled off with a bunch of folks.
I told you that day I was from Oregon. I'm not going to get arrested.
Yeah, you could have gone. We had a good time that night. I mean, I got locked up with all these guys, and and they were tasking so hard, and they were talking and cussing. Then one of them whispered, "Isn't that Reverend Rice?" And then suddenly they all tried to act like they were saints.
Do you know what I remember about that day? Uh-huh. All the police force that was down the block, they had at least 75 policemen in riot gear. That's what the world was about.
These people kill each other and they don't send anybody out.
For Larry, yeah. I was saying, man, he's really famous with the law.
You know, what happened was that, people get murdered and they'll send a cop or two or three, or you call 911, it takes forever to come. But that day, just totally, I think I had the men in blue, must have had 5% of the police force, 10% of the police force out there.
Just a piece of property on the corner. And I'm saying, for one individual, and we had a tent up, we had a great day of preaching. God was there. It was our property. And they had seemingly the whole police force there. I'm saying this is just insane. This is the way the world works.
What the Holy Spirit saying, stay calm, kill them with kindness, kill them with kindness. And I just went out of the way. And then later I met one of the officers arrested, and we were at a joint meeting together, and he said, he was one of the nicest guys that ever got arrested. And then when I was locked up with the jailers, and I found out one of the jailers, he was a minister. He came, I did a show with him later. It was just a tremendous opportunity to minister, and I had a captive audience too, and it had such a great time ministering. They finally locked me up in a cell all by myself, and I got the best night's sleep I'd gotten in months.
Can I tell you something personal about that day that I got to do? We were prevented. When they tore down the tent city down on the other side, they just kept us out of there. They said, no, you can't go back there. So when they came to that property that day, some of the assistants to the public works guy who did all the tent, the Bull Connor of St. Louis at that time. So he had all these little assistants, and I went up and said, you can't come on our property.
That's great.
Well, they were so mad. Like, I said, well, this is private property. You're not allowed on our
land.
I had a little fun.
I guess so. That was under the Slay administration. And the man that did all that was head of public safety at the time. You know what they did? They turned around and made him head of the whole department of helping the homeless later. It's really strange. Head of human services is what they made him. They made him head of human services after that when Bill Seedoff retired. So I don't know. This is the welcome to St. Louis. And what's happened now, since they put us out of our building, the Lord has sent me to the streets. Yeah. And what I do on Sundays is go around with my printed sermon, and we hand them out along with bags of food, and have this little congregation of about 75, 80 people that we hit every Sunday is our congregation out there. And great chance to minister.
But you know what I think about most when I think about it? I think about maybe the tens of thousands of people you've touched in these 50 years. See, people only saw you a lot of times on TV or doing worship. But I think about all the people you help with utilities, people you help with food, people you help with fans, people you've helped put in housing, men and women that have been on the street that either came through you or went through a ministry that you birthed. There have been thousands and thousands of people helped. And I think about the 10 lepers. That when I think about new life, I think about the 10 lepers. Jesus says, where are the nine? There are people who are in office in St. Louis. Politically, they might be nice homes, but they know you helped their mother and their grandmother and their father and their brother. And it's one of those things that I'm just so grateful for. You know, we read about Jesus feeding the 5,000 or the thousands. We may take one story out of that, but what about all the other ones he touched? And that is what the joy of new life has been to me, that God has touched more people in that sense of the church than most of them who had 2,000 on Sunday morning. Because most of those folks come there like going to the gym. They want to know more. They want to be in with the Lord when they're already in the Lord by Jesus. But they're still trying to fit in with the Lord. But the other people who came, the men and the women who struggled, the mothers and the children without homes, those are the people that new life helped. And I am so grateful for God having such a calling on you in these years. Now, that was a little button I put on. But see, that's what I realized. And I'm grateful for your former wife, Penny, because she touched a ton of women that none of them will come and say, but your ministry, if it ain't in the millions, and it wasn't just for a Sunday morning hookup, but for life itself. And that is why I'm so glad I was a part of, because it has influenced me in the way I live for the Lord now.
I'm talking to Pastor Matthew Carter, who's not only a mentor and a pastor and a comforter, but a personal friend. And he's been with me all those years, and he's somebody that I could just go to when I found myself grieving. I remember he came all the way from Oregon to be at Penny's memorial, and he made the statement, I'll never forget, she opened up her home to people that are in need. And he's with us when we put out a 1411 locust, and I would just as I'm lamenting, I'd write him, and he'd encourage me. And then when we sold 24-1, we went on 24-2, he did his encouragement. Because, you know, all of us have those moments. And thank you, Matthew, for your encouragement so we can continue to remain steadfast.
Thank you for showing what is more than words in the Bible, more than words than the life of Christ. It's a rare thing. I always think you're both a prophet in some ways on that side, because they don't want to hear it. And then on the other side, you're like Paul, that you care about people. God has done something for everybody, and you're not making a difference about it. And that is what I admire. And that is the guiding point for me to be that prophet, but also to be somebody who Christ, loving people that Christ died for, not judging them.
We've gone through a lot the last 32 years, it's about 32. Yes. You even walked with us to Jefferson City. We took that walk all that way, and you brought in friends from Oregon and California and all over, and it was quite an experience.
And they're all over the world. One of the guys is in Africa now doing a ministry. Yeah. I had my friend, my pastor, when I was in Oregon, he came to see me about 2 weeks ago, and we still write each other. Some of the other ones, once in a while, I see something, but like all of them, their lives were changed too, and I'm grateful for that. I'm still processing that walk. But it was a transitional time for me, because shortly after that, I got married and moved to Connecticut. So got it. And since that walk, I just told somebody, God renewed me in that walk to, you know, I got into my 70s. And I think sometimes I have been praying for a revived spirit about something. And these last since then, it's been amazing what God is doing.
The question is, and you got a few years on me, how do you keep getting better rather than bitter as you get older?
Because you really trust, you begin to really trust what God told him. I do a lot of Isaiah. I mean, when we talk Isaiah, Revelation, and Daniel, instead of looking at his end time thing, I look at what God can do for those who love him. I think too often in this day and time, the difference between those who know the Lord and those who don't, I see something happening that's different than the norm. I know God is doing some great things, because we have depended too much on American life, upon church. We have people saying, go back to church because I got to survive. I say, if church is only you going back in a building, there's something wrong with that.
Yeah.
I mean, and then for those who are uncomfortable, there are a lot of sermons now that talk about people being uncomfortable and that it's the end times. I'm saying, you've been comfortable all your life and now God has entered the scene. He's just trying to shake you up and say, look, where you've been all those years needs to change. It's not the end. It might be the end of you, but it's a beginning. I see a new beginning in what's going on. God is in work. I always think about, what did the people think when they were in slavery? And then all of these things happen, or how Pharaoh got worse. They were ready to leave town. That is what I'm seeing. God is doing a new thing in this earth. And we better pay attention and listen, because all of that stuff we did before is nothing.
Amen. You
know, we got to get out of them buildings. We got to do something like New Life has been doing for 50 years. We got to meet new people. Yeah.
But you can close a building, but you can't close a church. I want to take off on what you just said, though, about God is doing a new thing. As you know, he's raising up a new director of the New Life Evangelistic Center. More and more find myself helping this new director. You walked with him to Jefferson City. You've gotten to know him. Chris Aaron.
Great. He's a great, I look at his picture now. It's been a few years. He was a teenager. Now he's a man that has a family. And when I talk to him, it's, oh my God, the Lord has been in his life. Sometimes when you're that young, you don't realize what God has put in you. I think when we read about David and the people he called, we always, Jeremiah, like, I'm too young. We felt that way in a sense. But God is moving in a new way. And we need not be caught up in all the hype. You know, another part of moving us out in the first century church, a lot of them just wanted to be in Jerusalem. People don't understand. God is the one that moved them out of there. It wasn't because they wanted. And I know God is moving this church to a new place for those who know the Lord. But for those who are non-believers, they're just going to want to go back to Egypt anytime. And that's what you're hearing a lot in the church now.
I want to go back to Egypt. We used to eat good before the pandemic. That's exactly what they're saying. And I'm saying, come on, y'all. We are moving to a new land, a new promise. And that promise is to live for Christ fully.
Yes, we need to live in Christ. I agree with you.
I'm not crazy about it. And it's a message that New Life has been saying to all of these people for. Government don't know what it's doing. Churches don't know what it's doing. Businesses don't know, because the money, the power is slipping away. And God is saying, I'm going to give this to somebody else who understands who I am. And I'm grateful for that. America needs it. Our churches need it. We need it. We just know who God is and what he does. And we don't know at all.
Well, 2 Corinthians 5:17, the theme we've had all these years, if anyone be in Christ, they're a new creation, the old has passed away, the new has come. And as I get older, I don't only want to know the Lord, I want to be fully persuaded like Abraham was, and just to move forth. And yes, you may encounter a new devil when you move to a new level, but I want to just know that I know that I know, and just walk in obedience to the Lord. And that involves spending more and more time in the Word than I ever have before, and more time in the wonders of God's works of creation.
And I think you're on it. I think I've been reading Galatians, and Paul is coming to these new Gentiles who have come in faith, and all of a sudden they got these super apostles. Do we have a lot of them nowadays? God, they're all over the place. So they want them to get circumcised. Now, most of us think circumcision is like something back then. But I realize we're hearing, to be a Christian, you got to be also this. To be a Christian, you also got to be that. To be a Christian, you got to vote a certain way. You got to act a certain way. You got to look a certain way. And Paul said, that's nothing. Neither circumcision nor uncircumcision meaneth availeth none. It's only the new creation that matters. And I'm learning that is what God is saying and has been saying. We just add to Christianity everything, just circumcise ourselves up and down. And it has something that we've had to face. It's not Christianity and something. It's by faith alone. And let me tell you, that clears the deck.
Well, we're just about out of time. And I want to thank my dear friend, Matthew Carter, from North Carolina, for joining us as we're celebrating 50 years of God's faithfulness. We're going to have to do this again, Matthew. We got a lot more to talk about. This was fantastic. We thank our producer and director of this show, Bob Demler, and for putting this together. And we're going to continue to celebrate 50 years of God's faithfulness. Continue to keep us in your prayers, Matthew. We'll continue to keep you. I'm looking forward to getting your next letter. And God is great. God bless
working
you, my brother.
On it right now.
All right. Well, good to talk to you. It's just so exciting to hear from Pastor Matthew Carter. Now, a lot of you out there have memories over the years from New Life Evangelistic Center. I haven't heard from you. I've been asking you to please share those, and you can send those to me at P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri, that's 63166. You can put them in my attention, Larry Rice, and let us get those letters, write out the memories you have. Maybe you helped at the Thanksgiving dinner in the past, the Christmas dinner in the past, but I'm asking you to please share those with us right now. You got memories, we want them, because we're celebrating 50 years of God's faithfulness. I want to also ask you to put on your calendar for January 22nd. We're going to have a great multimedia presentation, a great event taking place at a great restaurant. You're invited. For further information, call us at 421-3020 as we celebrate 50 years of God's faithfulness. Truly, the Lord is good.